Amen, amen. Let's give it up for Sounds of Sanctuary. S-O-S. Woo. Amen. Thank you, young people. Wow, isn't that amazing? You know, they're getting better and better every week. Amen? Amen. Good job, guys. Bless you. Bless you. All right. I'd like to invite Mr. Noel, Greg Noel. Where's Greg? To come on up and give a brief report. There you are. And how do you change the slides?
That moves it forward. Good morning, everybody. I'd like to just share a few words this morning about the wilderness course that the brothers have been embarking upon the last couple years. And it's been a remarkable experience to be with them during this time, and as I'm sure all of you can feel a deep sense of gratitude to be part of this providence that's unfolding. So, you know, it was a interesting time. Father anointed Young Janim back in 2008 as the inheritor, the providential figure that was to continue the providence moving forward under Father's direction. And incredible progress was made in Korea, Japan, throughout the world, in establishing a victorious foundation under Father's guidance and direction. Both Young Janim and Cook Janim were really breaking through on many levels, political, religious, economic, cleaning up a lot of corruption, cleaning up a lot of the things that have been plaguing our movement for years and years. Finally, there was a movement toward getting on the correct path and moving forward into a new dispensation. So it was a very exciting time. I think all of us around the world felt a lot of hope and exhilaration what was happening. In the last 2 years of Father's life, Father called Young Janim to be by his side, and faithfully he served Father for 2 years. And at Father's ascension, it was clear that Young Janim was to take the leadership role of the worldwide movement. But obviously we know through since breaking the silence that did not happen, and it was a tragedy beyond measure. And now we see a situation where God's providence had to shift and actually move in a different direction. And, you know, so Young Janim and Cook Janim were in this position to leave the palace, so to speak, just as Moses was directed growing up in Pharaoh's palace, where he had an incredible future. If he had stayed in the palace of Pharaoh, then he would have been truly the ruler. But it was not to be, because Pharaoh's palace was not in accordance with God's will. And it was the same with the palace in Korea, where more and more it became clear to both Young Janim and Cook Janim to, in order to maintain the dignity of God and God's providence, God's will, and Father's desire, that they had to literally leave everything behind. An incredible worldwide foundation, everything was set up for that providence, but they had were directed by God to walk away from that and to start a new providence. So God guided them to Pennsylvania. It was a very interesting set of circumstances that led to that. There was hope that something could happen in New York, maybe centered on East Garden or New Hope Farms, which would be possibly the new car arms facility. But in the final moments of that, the New York governor announced the SAFE Act, and it became clear at that time that New York was no longer a possibility, and then Pennsylvania opened up. And it was at that time that True Father guided Young Janim and Cook Janim to look into Pennsylvania, and immediately things started to unfold. Property became available to Cook Janim, and 600 acres became available, and that became the new place for the factory. And then Young Janim moved into what is known as Lake Sanctuary back in March 2013. So this was a really special time. This was a time in his own personal home. We were able to have Sunday service and Bible studies. It was very warm and cozy. It was in the home environment. Very Spartan accommodations, like no furniture anywhere. But we gathered together to worship God, and it was a very special time. But it reached a point where there was so many people coming, and the homeowners association said, "No, this can't be happening here." There was cars parked up on the street, and some people started to complain that this was a problem. So a lot of personal sharings. So in the I already talked about that. So they got moved out of the Lake Sanctuary home for service and went to the Best Western, and this is a hotel over in Matamoras, Pennsylvania. And it was, we knew it was a temporary situation, but it was a spirit-filled location, and we stayed there for a couple months. And then in May 11th was the last Sunday service. Then May 18th, there was a service at the Newfoundland Firehouse right down the street. And on May 23rd, we closed on this building here that we're currently in, known as Sanctuary Church Newfoundland. And I don't know why the realtor donated his full commission. That was pretty remarkable, because this person, who's a top realtor in the region, has been very, very supportive. He helped find the property that Cookchenham's factory was built on, and has been an incredible asset and a blessing. And he donated his full commission. And it's been remarkable for me to witness Yongjinim and Cookchenim doing tribal Messiah work and having such an impact in the local community. This is something that's unprecedented in a way, where we've been asked to do tribal messiahship by Father, but here the True Children are really taking responsibility and setting an example themselves to make an impact in the local community. So Yongjinim has been asked on multiple occasions to offer the keynote prayer at many local events, and this is one such occasion where he not only offered the prayer, but spoke about constitutional issues to local leadership. And then there was the Midbar Providence. This was a remarkable time period. This was toward the end of 2014, where Yongjinim, I think, was really receiving a lot of pressure internally, spiritually, to move the Providence to the next level. So he was, just his father was driven to the ocean on multiple occasions to find God deeper in prayer, Yongjinim chose the deep cold of Pennsylvania to find God. And I had the great pleasure of being with him on many of these overnight outings, where it just happened to be the coldest time period in Pennsylvania history, I think, where several nights it was below zero. And it was probably the most frigid experience of my life. I have never experienced such cold. And but Yongjinim, I was just so impressed by his heart of offering during that time. He never uttered one word of complaint. He only had words of praise for God, and he would be getting up in the middle of the night, stoking the fire, because if we didn't have a fire burning, we would literally be dead today. we did 5 o'clock Hunduke, and just such a heart of offering, and I think God was really working to touch his heart to step into this anointing that Father gave him back in 2008. And it was on this foundation that that Yongjinim started delivering very, very strong sermons, starting with Breaking the Silence, January 18th, 2015. And it was something that had to be done, this kind of harsh analysis of what the world church was doing to Father. And I know for myself, and I think I speak for many others, that we had no idea that such a desecration was happening until he brought it to our attention. And we began to realize just how serious this is, that when you violate the word of God, this is unforgivable and something that cannot be tolerated. And because of his anointing by God, he could not be in a position to compromise that at all. And he had to speak out, just like Jesus at the time in Matthew 25, where he was chastising the scribes and Pharisees, where the woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, you hypocrites. It was in that same kind of spirit that he started delivering very strong messages to hopefully wake up the worldwide movement that Father had put so much heart and love into for the past 40, 50 years, and to reclaim Father's tribe that had fallen into this deception and tragic mistake. And then on April 21st, holding the holy blessing, returning to True Father's authority, this was a very significant event for Father, because once again, blessed couples could be reclaimed back into the covenant of God's lineage. And this is something that, again, will be happening next Sunday. It's a very significant, I think Richard will be speaking on that in a little bit. Cook-Janim, just a remarkable event. Just 2 weeks ago, the opening of his new car arms facility. To me, I was just, my jaw dropped to the ground, witnessing the incredible impact that he has had in 1 year in Pike County and in Pennsylvania. Because of his strategy, his intelligence, his business prowess, he is able to network with the highest levels of leadership in Pike County and Pennsylvania. And the kind of testimonies that were given to him show that God is really working through him in a powerful way to bring Freedom Society about, starting here in Newfoundland and then spreading out to Pennsylvania and to the nation. Yeah. So Sanctuary Church has really gone through an incredible transformation in the short time we've been here. Based on the very generous supports of our worldwide membership and all of you, we've been able to make some significant improvements to the building, and we're going to continue those improvements going forward. But just recently, we had a new roof put on by a local company. And it was, again, based on the generous support of all of you that this was made possible. And now we no longer have leaks everywhere. And we're going to have a heating and cooling system installed soon. So hopefully winter will be a lot more comfortable than it was last winter. And we're going to create new offices in the back with a warehouse and possibly a school. A sanctuary school is in the making. There's so many exciting plans ahead. And I just every day when I come here and work, and I really feel that God's blessing is showering upon Sanctuary and showering upon Yongjinim and Cook-Janim as the victorious Cain and Abel that Father anointed back in 2008. And I'm just so grateful to be part of this ministry, this growing ministry, and thank you all very much.
Thank you, Greg. Thank you for that historical survey. It's interesting. You don't. It's like a lot of our members from across the world have never actually heard some of the things, you know, that God led us through, and we're just so grateful. We're so grateful to, you know, to God and everybody else who we ended up meeting in the Midbar wilderness in sub-zero temperatures. That night was minus 36 degrees, Greg. Minus 36, right? Alex, you saw that on your temperature, right? Where's Alex? He saw that, minus 36. But very good, very good. You know, the wilderness is beautiful. Okay, and I'd like to ask Dr. Richard Panzer to come up. There's Richard. And share a couple of words. Thank you.
My wife tells me I better use my glasses, so I'm going to be obedient and follow her advice. Right, Miho?
So,
I'll be sharing a short explanation about the blessing taking place actually next Sunday. But before I do that, I want to do a really quick reading from Father's words in Blessing an Ideal Family about the blessing. Today, all women who believe in the Unification Church and want to be saved are brides who have come to look for a bridegroom. Therefore, with whom are they supposed to be one? They have to become one with the coming Christ. They have to become one with Adam and one with God. Understand that I am speaking of a spiritual oneness centered on God. I gave out that kind of vertical love before, and many people followed me. Do you like Father too? Persons who can see the spiritual world understand that Father helps them as their older brother, husband, and father. That is the formula. Therefore, you must center on Father more than on any other man in this world. You would see the reality of this if you could look through the spirit world. And that's from Blessing Ideal Family, chapter 4. The holy blessing for returning to True Father's Authority ceremony will take place on August 30th, marking the third anniversary of True Father's Sunghwa. All blessing ceremonies held by the Family Federation during the intervening period were not performed in unity with True Father's Blessing Covenant. February 22nd, 2013, which the Family Federation celebrates as Foundation Day, was a day when the Family Federation disunited with True Father by abandoning the blessing covenant that he sacrificed for and purchased with his own blood. The blessing offered on that day was not performed in unity with Father. For that reason, the blessing given that day did not bring any of the couples into the new lineage established by Father. Couples who participated in the Foundation Day blessing, or individuals who took the holy wine, need to receive the holy marriage blessing for returning to True Father's authority and holy wine before the end of the year. There are more details on our website. We are very fortunate to have the inheritor couple, Hyunjinim and Yeonim, officiating a blessing ceremony that is united with Father's authority on August 30th. I hope that many of you will join us there in person or through the internet. May God bless you.
Thank you, Richard. And can I invite Mr. Tim Elder to share a couple words?
Thank you very much. A couple weeks ago, I told you about some developments in Japan and Korea especially, where the Family Federation was putting out public memos and statements to all members, encouraging them or instructing them not to have anything to do with Sanctuary Church or its members. Remember, they told there were five instructions. I don't have them here right now, but don't listen to people who are engaged in unprincipled claims or activities, and don't go to places where unprincipled activities are going on, such as Chungpyeong. So I thought I'd follow up today to report on what happened since then. Are people following those instructions? Are the supporters of Sanctuary Church in Japan and Korea dwindling away to nothing? Well, you know, Mr. Sangyeol Lee in Korea, when he was anointed here, went back. He rented a space that seats about 50 people. And he was having about, 35, 40, 45 people. So what happened to his congregation? What happened to their attendance after these public instructions? Well, last Sunday he had 70 people. But the room only fits 50. So people don't have a place to sit. They share a meal afterwards like we do. They don't have a place to eat. So they're looking for a larger place. And in Korea, 275 people have now received the blessing for returning to True Father's authority. And what about Japan? Japan translated those instructions that were given by the Korean church and asked their people please don't associate with these people that call themselves Sanctuary Church. Don't go to their if any one of them contacts you, you have to report it immediately to your pastor. So what's happening there? Well, as Hyungjinim has reported, we have two main groups in Japan. One under Mrs. Erikawa. And she is a very influential person in Japan. And the Family Federation was very shaken and continues to be shaken by her coming out in public now, supporting Sanctuary Church and Father's work through Hyungjinim and Yonanim. And so yesterday and today, yesterday they gathered all the major leaders in eastern Japan and had a meeting with them. And today, Sunday, they're gathering all the leaders in western Japan and having a meeting with them. And the message of this meeting is, watch out for Mrs. Erikawa. And she's reporting that it's great because, you know, she wanted everyone to know that she's now making this public stand, but it's hard to get that information out. But thanks to the Japanese church, the Family Federation, now everybody knows about it. And she's getting phone calls from people. Oh, what's going on? I want to know, hear from you directly. Why are you making this change? And she's telling them, well, it's because I'm not leaving Father. I'm not leaving Father, but I'm leaving the Family Federation that has left Father so that I can remain loyal to Father, so I can remain in a state of absolute obedience to our true Father. In Japan now, there's in the Japanese Family Federation and around that, there's a phrase being used called the hidden sanctuarians. This is actually a reference to a period in Japanese history when there was the hidden Christians who maintained their faith for more than two centuries, two and a half centuries, from generation to generation, despite a very severe persecution from the government at the time. And they were forced to hide their faith, but also pass it on from generation to generation. And now we have the hidden sanctuarians in Japan, where people who are telling Mrs. Erikawa, I agree with you, and I want to work with you, but, you know, I have my job, I have my friends, I have our children and their friends. Like our pastor was saying last week, there's fear. And fear is what? Do we remember from last week's sermon? Fear is the gift of Satan. And some people have yet to be able to put down that gift. Fortunately, the Family Federation does not have the power of a state. It does not have a military. It does not have its own police, such as the hidden Christians had to deal with in the past. So it's actually not an accurate comparison. People can do that. People can just say no and can make the right choice. People can make the right choice. But there's people who are still on the process of doing that. But more and more people are able to do that. I received a testimony from a Japanese man this morning by email. And he said that I'm doing street witnessing since August 14th. I'm doing this because Hyungjinim said that we should all go out onto the front line. But I'm also doing it because my conscience tells me to. See, people are watching these sermons. People are watching Hyungjinim's sermons. And even after the U.S. Family Federation forced us to stop using Father's symbol and forced us to cover it up, even in our sanctuary, still people are watching the videos. Last week's sermon, I checked this morning, had 1,748 views when I checked it a couple hours ago. And that's as much or more than we were getting in the first seven-day period in the past. And in Japan, most people in urban areas commute by subway or train. So the best place to witness usually is a train station. And so that's what this man is doing. And he said, on the first day I was out, I met a woman who was the women's leader in our local church. So God's guiding people to him. The first day out. And he spoke with her. And the important thing that he said to her is, don't let yourself remain in ignorance. Go online and go to the blogs, because there are many Japanese blogs that as soon as Hyungjin gives a sermon, there are people in Japan who start translating it. And it's usually translated by the evening. They work incredibly fast. But the woman said to him, "No, I don't read anything that is not an official memo from the Family Federation." Well, and he says, "Well, if that's true, how come you're not out witnessing? You're supposed to have, the Family Federation says they're going to have 1 million members in Japan by 2020. Now, that would be about the same number of members as all of Christians put together, Protestant, Catholics. So about 1% of Japan is Christian. That would be a little more than 1 million people. If they're supposed to be fulfilling that goal, how come this person who claims to be reading the public memos is not out witnessing?" And he says, because they're afraid. Especially because if they're at the station, they might run into someone they know, right? And they're afraid of that. So they go to places where, or if they witness at all, they go to places where they're not going to run into anyone they know. But they don't go to the place where God is guiding people to meet them. In Japan and in Korea, things are developing very quickly. The Family Federation knows that their efforts are for naught, that things are crumbling under their feet. People are afraid, but they don't need to be, because if they can make the right choice, God will work with them, and Father will work with them, and will guide them on the right path. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Tim. Wow, what an amazing, there's an amazing move of the Spirit. There's an amazing move. And today we want to talk about the building of real Chanyaguk. And we want to start, let's go back to the beginning, Genesis 1, and let's read this together. From verse 27, let's read together. "So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female created he them. And God blessed them, and God said unto them, Be fruitful, and multiply, and replenish the earth, and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over every living thing that moveth upon the earth. And God said, Behold, I have given you every herb bearing seed, which is upon the face of all the earth, and every tree, in that which is the fruit of a tree yielding seed, to you it shall be for meat. And to every beast of the earth, and to every fowl of the air, and to everything that creepeth upon the earth, wherein there is life, I have given every green herb for meat, and it was so. And God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good. And the evening and the morning were the sixth day." Amen. You know, we're in such an interesting time, and we're in a time which is very serious too. We've seen what has happened under the Han mother's leadership. We know the whole story. We know what happened. The principles of Genesis 1 to establish the kingdom. Adam and Eve had that responsibility. And last week we saw what happens when the final offering is not made. Satan can snatch away the dove. And that's what happened. We see that the change of true father, this is not in line with the building of the kingdom of God. Changing and redacting the Holy Bible, the Word, 80% up to. That is a tremendous, tremendous sin. And we know these things, the Chanyaguk National Anthem, which was, of course, thrown away. We know where that comes out from. The blessing, Flammy Pledge, the blessing vows, the blessing sacrament itself, on a quest to become goddess, to change the nature of God, and to now teach diatheism, which then, of course, separates us from all of providence, excluding the DP from the Constitution of Chanyaguk, or the kingdom, essentially became a slave document, centralizing all of power under Chungpyeong, you know, the false institution that has aided and embedded in the treason against your father. We see that the Han mother also left her position and tries to ride on father as a subject, putting herself as God and Messiah and only begotten daughter, promoting the Han tribe lineage over the Messiah's lineage, dethroning true father, erasing the true father's lineage from the covenant blessing, right? Even forcing legal action to put father's face and the symbol of God's grace for the world covered up. So we see this has happened. We have seen these things, and everybody knows we begged her not to go down this path because it is a path of destruction. It's a path of that will lead to destruction, narcissism. It will lead to being humbled by God. We can see, of course, the actual, with our own eyes, we can see the replacing of father and the position, and the original positions given to man and woman, husband and wife, Adam and Eve at the garden. We can see, of course, even the removing of father from the name of the blessing. Thousands of these rings went out as a blessing covenant with no Messiah there. That's unbelievable. That alone should shock anybody who sees that. And of course, the legal counsel. And as I promised, all the totalitarians hate to see father's written declaration. Why? Because they know the inheritor and successor, and they know that father said any other who claims to be that is a heretic and destroyer, and they know they are heretics and destroyers. They know it, but they don't want to admit it. They don't want to admit that they are usurpers, desecrators of father. So we're in the Shemitah. The Shemitah also is happening in reality and is a reflection of the internal nature of the providence that has happened. The betrayal, the desecration, the leaving, the straying from God, the arrogance, the apostasy that the people of God do against God. And then what happens then when they do that? Well, God sends warnings, and now the warnings are getting very large. Right? Just as we see the Dow is collapsing, and one day 530 points just shattering. Russia, China trading out of the dollar, doing joint military exercise the first time they're doing joint military exercises. We see the world market is crashing in many different areas. We see the currencies in different countries literally losing 25% of its value within one day, last week. Same patterns of 2001, 2008 collapses. We see the same Shemitah patterns, but now on a larger scale, now cascading as we race towards the end of the Shemitah, September 13th. And this is all coming about at the exact time where Father's third year ceremony of ascension is happening. And the warning that he gave to us, that if we stray from him, then judgment will come upon us. He said at one point that half of Korea will be killed. There will be death. Japan, he said, islands will fall into the sea if we stray from God. Those were all prophecies that he already had given many years ago. And we can see that those things, when the people get so defiant that they become numb and deaf to the cries and warnings of God, then there is calamity does come. We see the MERS virus all of a sudden appear just in South Korea, which actually shuts down the palace. It shut down Cheongpyeong. And that we talked about 5-6 months earlier about, hey, if the Cheongpyeong gets shut down, you know that's a sign. Everybody saw that around the world. And then MERS comes and shuts down Korea. And just this week, we have again military conflict by North and South Korea. This week, wartime state is declared, and North and South Korea exchange fire at the border. Those are tanks. Those are tanks, folks. They are shooting at each other now. So this is not a joke. What God has told and warned of, when the people of God stray from him and when they desecrate him, they think it's unnecessary. They think their prosperity comes from them and not from God. Well, then there's a big wake-up call that comes. We are running down that line where we are now at the final, the super Shemitah, and as that rolls on. But it's interesting because as we have one more week to the blessing, yes, we want to focus on the blessing and we're preparing like mad here, preparing for the blessing. Everybody is participating and volunteering and just getting ready, you know, mentally, psychologically, spiritually, you know, for all these people that will come and stand with us on that day. And we, of course, know that, you know, August 30th will be a cosmic event. When Father's third year is up, we will see the direct dominion of Father in a more mighty way. People will have more powerful visions, faster, direct contact, very quickly, because a three-year time period of mourning is over. And so that is right down the corner, that we know that's right there. But at the same time, it's important for us to understand why, when there's a judgment, what God is trying to do. God is not judging his people in order to destroy them. There would be no reason to give warnings in. He gives warning and he calls them back to him because he wants to have them return, have to turn from their wicked ways, repent of their sins, and receive his grace and mercy, forgiveness. And then he wants them to rebuild. So they actually have to rebuild. It's not only about getting spiritual forgiveness from God or turning from our spiritual wickedness. We then have the task of actually rebuilding the kingdom. What is the kingdom that will be built after the judgment? How will God's people recreate God's will on earth? And this is when we see Satan versus God's kingdom. We can look at this in the natural world, and we see this in the world today, that Satan really is the prince of, you know, the darkness that rules over this earth. We have in Satan's system, which of course all the fallen church is following in that way, we have a slave model. And these are things that are very practical to people's lives, a direct impact on people's lives. They have a slave model versus a freedom model, a free association. They have centralized government, centralized power, colluding with big financial bankers and things like that, that put people into traps, that make them slaves to them financially. So all your work is paying off bills. All your work is paying off loans that you've taken. You're never a free person. You're paying back loans to these big monopolists. So you have that kind of slave model. It's morphed into more of a financial slave model. But that is existing in all parts of the globe today. We also see the inculcation versus empowered education. We see inculcation through public education, drilling the children. Literally, they have to believe this, or you're racist. You have to believe that, or you're a bigot. You have to support gay marriage, or otherwise you're evil. Everything is inculcated into them, and peoples are not taught to learn to move with their conscience, learn of the law that God has written on their heart, and things like that, versus empowered education, like homeschooling. We have a system in the world which some people call sick care, where they're caring, big companies are monopolizing the care of the sick, as opposed to real health care, which is actually thinking about proactive things. We have security by the state, guaranteed by all big tyrannical governments and powers, always guaranteeing us safety through the state, as opposed to each individual who is free can defend themselves. Amen. And this is what's so exciting, because we are moving towards a blessing, yes, but also it doesn't stop at the blessing, because God's rebuilding will happen after that point continuously, and it will continue to move forward. And that is why we, all of us here, many of us have started learning how to work and learn how to have that pioneer spirit, to be able to defend yourself from predators, to learn how to defend your home from intruders, to have ownership of your residence, to understand that God has given you the sovereign gift to be sovereign owner of his part of his creation, and that you have a responsibility and duty to protect that kingdom. Right? So many of us have trained now here while we're here, you know, in the wilderness. Many of us have also taken different directions, not following the system that is created by the world, by Satan's system. You know, the system that you go to elementary school, you go to middle school, then you go to high school, then you go to college, and then you get a student loan, and you're paying that off for 20 years, and then you get married, you have 2.5 children, and have a dog, and have a white picket fence, and then you get your house loan, or home loan, and pay your mortgage payment until you're 60, 70, 80 years old. And that's the system, and that's what you have to get into. That's what you have to do to be normal. But many of us are not following that path at all. We are rejecting that system that the world and Satan's world has created artificially over people, calling it the real life. Escaping that. Not deciding not to take student loans. Many of our young people, even my children, I tell them all the time, do not take student loans. Many people learning to make money for themselves as they graduate from high school. Homeschooling. Make money, learn on the job profession. Then as you make money, take online courses while you have your own money and you're not in debt and you can pay your courses slowly at your own pace. You don't need to graduate in 2 or 4 years. There's no eternal law that says you have to graduate college within 4 years, otherwise you'll never succeed. That's baloney. That is what Satan's system puts on you. But see, what's so wonderful is that the people that are gathering here, we're not accepting that path either. Satan's system. We're thinking differently. We're thinking counterculturally. We're thinking in that sense, radically in that sense, radically centering ourselves on God, but also being radically free and responsible people. Very important as a center of the kingdom. Being debt free, whoopee, super awesome, I'm debt free. It's so important to be debt free if you're a young person. So we are exploring these things in sanctuary, and we are building these types of associations, building these types of movements. We're not just here haranguing at the failing family church, Family Fed, which has desecrated Father. We speak the truth, but at the same time, we're also here, and we're building actual kingdoms, building communities. Not of socialism, not of communism, but of free association, freedom and responsibility, where we respect each other as made in the image of God, free and responsible people that come together for a purpose and a common mission. That is the glory, that is, of course, the glory of God. We are choosing not to send our kids to brainwashing centers. Well, you must obey. You have to be politically correct all the time. And where if you disobey your school teacher authority, you are a villain. Right? And we've seen cases where high schoolers have been taken to prison just for that. Ridiculous. College, of course, another sexual brainwashing system where not only they speak about being open and being tolerant and knowing all ideas, but when you get into college, you realize very quickly there is an orthodoxy there, and it's very intolerant towards anything other than relativism. Anything other than relativism, especially sexual relativism, is bigoted. It's traditional marriage, oh, you're old-fashioned. That's what your parents put in you. You're not using your thing. Why don't you explore other things? All these kind of things. And that indoctrination process. So many of us are choosing to guide our children. Hey, college, guess what? You're just going to be overburdened with a student loan. Work as you get out of college. Get a job. Build your career. Start building your profession. And as you make the money, you can do your college thing. You can study over online. We live in an internet world. We don't have to go to that physical place and get indoctrinated with certain sexual culture, indoctrinated with certain things. We can be free. We can still get the skills. We can still have all the technology, but we can be free to make decisions. We don't have to be sucked up into the stamping process of these relativists and these communists. Many of us are also exploring the tiny house movement. Who says you can't be happy in a tiny house? There's an incredible movement all across America and now spreading to another parts of the world. They're making houses in shipping containers. Many young people deciding, you know what? I'm not going to be in debt for 70, 80 years of my life, and I want to own my property before I'm 25. I'm going to have my own property. I'm going to have my own house, and I'm going to be a free person. And this is the tiny house movement. Many of us are exploring that right now. Many of us are empowering our kids. Learn about this. Get ready to build your own house. Get ready to think about these things. You don't have to be part of this, the banker system that is set up for you to be a debt payer the rest of your life. There is alternatives to that. And this is what's so exciting about Sanctuary. We are exploring those things. Look at that. That's another shipping container, a house. Such creative ways that many sanctuary people who come to Sanctuary are now thinking about practically, how do I actualize the principles of Chanyugu? How do I actually live in the kingdom of God? How do we actually build a Chanyugu one house, family, you know, property at a time? How do we do that? How do we do that and not be slaves to the old system of Satan's domination? Look at these small little abodes, but places which are yours, places which you have dominion over, places which nobody can come in and kick you out. Amen. How good is that, right? Places where nobody can kick you out. All these things we're exploring here while we're also fighting a larger battle with Satan. Many of us, like Bluestone Farms, have educated now dozens and hundreds of people of leaving the sick care system and moving on to the health care system. Growing your own organic fruits and vegetables, raising your own livestock, learning how to hunt, right? Learning self-reliance, learning how to do things where you can provide God's bounty to you and your family. At the same time of you falling into this trap, learning medicinals, learning edibles. These are things that are happening in our community. Learning how to use actual things of creation, by the way, which almost all antibiotics are based off of, like willow bark, which is the main ingredient for aspirin. All these kind of things, we are moving to the alternative. Everything Satan's world says, this has to be the way, and if you don't do it this way, and you don't feed into the system, and you don't pay the money to the big pharma or the big banks or the big school, you are crazy. We're saying, God bless you. We're happy to be free, and we're happy to be, if you want to call that crazy, call it crazy. But we're happy to be free and responsible. Stewards of the earth, right? Choosing, you know, real things of creation, not the artificial. And here, I had not hunted for 15 plus years. I went hunting a couple times with my brothers when I was younger, but I hadn't hunted in 15 years. I had a terrible experience that I've told you many times where we went hunting. I caught this huge, huge whitetail when I was in high school with my brother in Alaska. But the experience was so bad, not because of the hunting, but because he constantly would belittle you all day long and make fun of you all day long. So it was literally torture to be with him. So because of that, I hadn't hunted in like years. Just because of that. It had nothing to do with hunting, but it had everything to do with that experience. But coming back here, getting back into wilderness, coming back to a sense of, you know, a seriousness of, wait a minute, we have to be self-reliant. We lost everything. We stepped away from everything. We have to learn how to become self-reliant. What do we have to do? Learning these skills again. Getting back to the ancient knowledge, the tribal knowledge. Getting into bushcraft and survival training and things like that. Practicing. Even my beautiful wife practiced training, doing some training out in the wilderness. Drinking from her birch bark cup. And it's a beautiful kuksa. You know, our other gentlemen joining us. I know you will not notice who that ninja is on the right side, but that's Greg Knoll. You may not discover that's him, but that's him. And who knows? Frigid temperatures, having bacon and bagels in the frigid cold. Doing this type of training, learning survival, testing ourselves, pushing ourselves in the wilderness. The wilderness is the midbar. The Midbar comes from the word Dabar, which means the Word of God. So in the Midbar is the place where you meet Dabar, the Word of God. It's a place where you can meet with God. If you get out of your comfort zone, step out into reality, step away from the fantasy of the computer games and the TV, and step into the real world. That's where you're going to meet God. If you walk in to a dense forest, go swimming in a lake, go hunt a whitetail. Go tromp around for a bear. Go fishing. Go encounter the natural world, God's creation, that he commanded us to subdue, commanded us to be stewards over. We encounter his word there. We have a wonderful thing that we're doing. I wanted to share these things today because I want to show people, look, we're not only focusing on the end of the Shemitah. Yes, the end of Shemitah is coming, and there is a judgment that is coming, but we keep moving forward. We're going to keep moving forward, and we're going to keep empowering our children, creating intergenerational succession plans for their success so they're able to provide for their families in freedom and responsibility as owners of Chunnyaguk. We don't stop it at August 30. We keep moving forward, building the kingdom. And this is a wonderful thing we're doing now. We are now building a reciprocal roof frame structure, a hunting cabin with only hand tools, no electric tools, cutting down trees, debarking them with little knives, you know, getting the hand tool experience like the pioneer fathers. What a great experience. These kids would never have it, and they would have never volunteered to do it, but because I'm their daddy, I say, you're coming. These skills you'll never forget. And one day they'll build their house for their wife, and they'll build their house for their children, and they'll learn how to provide, learn thinking, self-reliance. Not thinking I'm going to get a stamp. Not thinking I'm going to get something from this or that organization. I'm here to be free. I'm here to be responsible. I'm here to succeed and to flourish and live with what God has given me. Prosper, be abundant with what God has given me. One of the greatest things God has given us is our creativity. God has given us this, and this is what's so exciting, because sanctuary is probably the only place in the world now that is not only holding to Father's ideal, but that is trying to live like Father lived. Using that creativity in the natural world, whether it be the Amazon jungle, the Pacific Ocean, or deep sea, whatever it is, go into nature, go into reality, pull out the plugs of all the technological fantasy, and plug in to reality. This whole thing got me just saturated in Father's Word, because a whole section on Chunsung is about ocean providence, nature providence, farming providence. And honestly, I had not looked at that for a long time. You know, we're usually checking out the other verses on the different elements of Father's Word, but there's a huge section on things like this. Chunsung 1905, up to this day, I've overcome everything from this wretched world. There's nothing, anything I do not know about, and there isn't anything I cannot do. I can do anything. If I go to a farming village, I can be the king of farmers. I know well what to cultivate on certain types of land. When I go to the sea, I am the king of fishing. He's already famous for Reverend Moon's tuna fishing system. Such an integral part of Father's life that we conveniently hide away. Amen. Whisk away, but when actually serving him, you would be in contact with the natural for the majority of the time. Whether you are on a desert, Lake Mead in the middle of Nevada, baking under 120 degree sun, or whether you're on the Pacific Ocean with 9 to 10 foot swells and waves, or whether you're in the Amazon jungle, running around with crocodiles and anacondas and stingrays on the bottom, Father moved into the wilderness always, go into nature. He talked about if you just have 100 pyeong, your household will have enough income for all the children to go to college, yet you could still live comfortably. Talk about self-reliance. Talk about thinking, how do we as the kingdom's citizens, how do we as people live? How do we succeed? How do we move with what God has given us? Amen. Father was always thinking about this thing. This was an essential part of his ministry. It was an essential part of his life going out into this. Look at this. We have the ability to draw seawater, et cetera. We can build fishing farm structures in the Pocono Mountains. Well, in the mountains. As many as we need. In the time of the Shemitah, where millions of people are now realizing they're unprepared, Father was already thinking about this decades ago. And he already built that technology. Building fish farm structures and self-reliant structures everywhere around the world. This is what Father was talking about. Freedom and responsibility. Not centralized power. Not communal communism living. Not centralized hierarchies. Centralized governments. This is not what the Messiah was talking about. He was talking about a radical, radical self-reliance. A total oneness with working with the land. Working with God's creation. A give and take action as stewards of creation. It's such a radically countercultural view. And it's not a view that the big systems want us to have. And that is why it's so liberating. It's so freeing to be working to something which empowers you, which gives you real creativity, allows you to unleash all of those talents with your children intergenerationally for God's kingdom. Father talked about there will be a time where you can hunt animals, even tigers, and breed wolves, release them into hunting grounds, and bears, and breed animals for hunting. He already was doing that in Canada, breeding the deer there. Again, things that we want to cover up about Father. The fallen church wants to hide above. Father never touched a gun. No, he shot 12-gauge shotguns, everybody. He shot 12-gauge shotguns. You understand? Oh, he never touched him. Oh, no, he never could touch him. He could never could touch a weapon. He's a Messiah. He shot 12-gauge shotguns, whether he's pheasant hunting, whether he's rabbit hunting, whether he's tuna fishing. That's reality. You see, that's a Father that's hidden from you. That's a Father that they don't want you to see. That's a Father that's radically self-reliant and radically empowered. Not scared to go out into a undeveloped jungle and create a civilization there. Not scared. Here I am with the straw Marlboro hat. I don't know why they gave me a Marlboro hat. But somebody took it. I borrowed it from some guy on the fishing. That's on the Pacific Ocean. Father, until he was 92 years old, was out on the Pacific Ocean. 9-foot whale swells. You understand? I mean, do you know how unbelievably terrifying it is to be on a boat where you are jumping off the thing every time it goes up and down? Your stomach is literally in your throat. This is the types of lifestyle that invigorated him. He felt alive, not in the palace and all the luxury, but in the wild. That is the Pacific Ocean. We are now right there. We are near one of the lowermost islands in Korea called Paekdo. Totally in the middle of nowhere. Father loved it. Doesn't matter if you didn't want to go. Doesn't matter if you were complaining about it the other night. Doesn't matter. You're going. And what a beauty. I remember being down with Father in a Pantanal Amazon jungle for months at a time because I was studying jiu-jitsu there, Brazilian jiu-jitsu. And when Father was away, then I would go to São Paulo and study jiu-jitsu there. And then when he came back, then I would have to go back to the Campo Grande, which is like a couple hour, you know, plane flight, like this small little plane, this rickety old thing. You go out there, there's nothing there. A bunch of, you know, vacas, you know, all you got is cows walking around. You know, and then there's these rivers where you have alligators at every turn. You have these little, you know, I can't remember what these little groundhog things that are swimming around. What are they called? What are the groundhog things? I can't remember. Capybara, something. You have the piranhas that are in the water. And we, you know, at first we were saying, why do we have to be here? Why does Father keep taking us? This mosquito infested, black fly infested, being eaten alive. You talk about, my children complain sometimes about walking through the woods up here in Pennsylvania, getting eaten by mosquitoes. I said, child, you have not experienced a mosquito until you get down to the Pantanal Amazon jungle. Because the mosquitoes are that big, the black flies are that big, and the vampire bats come out to bite you at night. And in that context, and oh, okay, Pennsylvania mosquitoes, not so bad. But if I reflect on my life, if I reflect and I think, If I didn't have those experiences, if we did not swim down that path, we so stupidly swam down the river because we were so ignorant. Me, my Kuk Jin Hyung and Hyun Jin Hyung, we swam down this river because we, you know, we first day we got there, we're like, hey, this is a beautiful river, a little waterfall, jump in there. We decided to swing off trees and jump near the waterfall. We later found out that somebody died in that waterfall. As we were swinging, we saw this huge anaconda in the water under some rocks. And so we decided to go on the other side and swim down the river. And so we're swimming down the river, our feet are on the ground, and later they tell us they have stingrays on the ground that can kill you if you step on the ground. And we're wading through neck-high water, swimming down this Amazon jungle river, and there's alligators everywhere. The hand of God was on us, because if it was not on us, we'd be dead. We'd be some kind of food for some kind of beast. But we have that experience. What a great experience. I never forget that experience. I never, never forget that experience. And I want my children, I want my intergenerational succession plan and my intergenerational training that I train my kids in. I want them to have some taste of that, even though it's not exactly that, some taste of that in God's creation. That is something so valuable, and that is something so key in Chanigook. If you think about it, if the next generations of the kingships are being raised in marble palaces, in luxury, everybody doing everything for them. They never picked up an axe. They never picked up a saw. They don't know how to use a knife. They don't know how to shoot a gun. Whatever it is, you know? And they live in opulence their whole life. How will they ever be able to build God's kingdom? All they will build is the same tyranny of the Satans of the past. The monarchies of the past will build Satan's power. And that is why it's such an empowering thing to be able to do this. I say, kids, we don't own our house. That's not our house. We could be kicked out anytime. Right? So we have to build a log cabin, a hunting cabin. It's for a temporary structure. So let's say there is some situation. Well, we can always have some place. It doesn't have electricity. It doesn't have internet. It doesn't have running water. It doesn't have propane gas. But it's someplace. Then my children, talking to their cousins, 5-year-old cousins, say, hey, you know, we may be kicked out of this house one day, and we may have to live in the wilderness. That's empowerment, folks. That is thinking empowerment at a young age. That's a good thing. No fear. Facing the darkness and facing the wilderness, facing it with less and less fear as they become acquainted with it. Father, that was such an essential part of his life. And as we're moving towards a blessing and we're moving towards returning to his authority, and now we're thinking as the cosmic shift is happening, and even if there's judgment across the world in different places, God still wants to build the kingdom of God on earth. He still needs to have another starting point for it to develop again. Not in the common pattern of humanity, which is always towards centralization and totalitarianism, but to free association, free peoples of God, freedom and responsibility. Those who honor God, humble themselves before him, help their neighbor. We don't rely on, you know, centralized power to protect us. We rely on ourselves, on our neighbors. We become each other's stewards. We become each other's brothers. And this is such a radically countercultural, but very American view. Very American view of how God moves providence forward. Amen. Amen. And this is so important for us, because as we move forward, and all the people who are now preparing, and many people I know around the world are preparing to come move here, well, you know what our principles are. Nobody's forcing you to move here. Nobody is compelling you to move here. If you're going to move here, these are principles. We are building the Chanigook, which is not based on Satan's centralized control tower power, but that is rooted in a relationship with God, a relationship with his gifts, a relationship with our generations that goes beyond what the boxes that are placed before us in society. that goes beyond what is offered to us in society, and that is in the line and direction of the Messiah. Amma, you want to say something on that real quick?
Let's give a one more big up round of applause to our Pastor Mu. Thank you. And looking at Father's picture, you know, it brings in the wild, brings so much memory to me, and it's a great honor to spend time with a true Father. In our lifetime, even though it was just one page of our life, it's amazing honor to spend time with him. You know, when I think about Father has lived a really transparent life, right? And I remember one time Father was like in a big crowd, in front of a big crowd. Father sitting in the middle on the chair, and he crossed his arm, crossed his leg like this, and then he just takes off his socks. And then he's smelling his socks. And he lets out, "Do you want to smell this too?" And he's so free, and he's like, he's totally free and transparent. And he's like, had no problem passing the gas and burping in front of people. But sometimes I feel like, oh, maybe he's too transparent here. Right? And we love Father that way, right? Father is so honest. He's like, whatever he does, in public, he's same in private. Whatever he tells member to do, he tells exact same thing to his physical family and to us. And when we think about Jesus' life, it's the same thing. In his 3 years of a public mission life, he did the same thing too. Wherever he goes, he let his disciple tags along with him. So they saw, they slept with Jesus in a communal way, they ate together, they prayed together, they gave sermon, and they're everywhere with Jesus' disciples and cloud of people. And Jesus lived a life that is transparent, right? And his public life and private life was same. I'm talking about this because this week my husband challenged me and saying, "You know what, honey? You are not transparent enough." Oh my God! What am I supposed to do more to transparent? And he's like, "You know what? You like manga and you like animation. You like the Totoro, and I'm sure there's many of Japanese sister and brother knows about it." I don't even like, I'm starting this story. I'm not only like Totoro, I love Totoro. And they're just so cute. And I have this collection of items that is about Totoro, and you're ashamed to share about those and show people about those. And I'm like, I feel kind of offended a little bit. Do I have to show those things to everybody? Who wants to see those things? My collection of Totoro. Appa, you know what? I understand your intention, but I think that went too much. I think too far. And he's like, I challenged him back, right? I challenged him back. And he said, honey, think about it. You know, I'm not just joking here. Think about it. You know, you don't want to show your big earrings to congregation, your big necklaces, and you present yourself some kind of nun and thinking that everybody you have, like, all the clothes you have is like a white shirts and black pants like a nun, right? So you are kind of feel not comfortable to share those things. And it's almost like you put yourself into divine being without you knowing. And can you say that is transparent? Okay, I have to admit that's like starting to get into me slowly. And that is like something, you know, it really got me to think. He didn't push me, further, but it got me to think, for a couple of days. And it is true. Without me knowing, I only want to show good side of me. And I think, it was not bad intentional thing that I tried to do. But, even like, I later on I asked him, honey, a couple of days later that was in my head, honey, I'm trying to be transparent. Look at my YouTube channel, it's like I'm showing my work to people, and that took me a lot of courage. I know it's not perfect, but I'm trying. And he said, See, that's exactly my point. You're only showing the part that you want to show to people, that religious part, and thinking that you are always thinking about this religious divine thing. I know you like shopping. You like to go shopping. And women like shopping, right? And I'm a woman too, so I like shopping too. And you know, we can go shopping. We can like to go Macy's without destroying our saving account, without like buying the whole store. Okay, I can see some men like shaking their head. That's not happening. But we can be frugal, right? We can go to Salvation Army and get shopping. Like get a nice, you know the meat bar, the wilderness, the training I went to, right, with my husband, that was possible because of Salvation Army. I could buy a lot of wool sweaters, you know, ladies like the padding jacket, whatever company it is, it doesn't work. The wool sweater, if you have a wool sweater, 3 layers of a wool sweater in the middle of winter, harsh winter, that gets you through. So that's something I advise, I want to give to you. So he's like, this really, you know, got me thinking. So wow, that's true. I have this discomfort about things that I don't want to show. And one thing that he struck me was, when you try, the more you try to hide things from public, and when your life is so different, radically different in private and public, then that's the space that Satan goes in. And then look, you know, she tried to be so holy, and she's like, she likes to go to shopping at Macy's, and she likes to go to whatever, you know, she has these pink shirts and, you know, zipper shirts with the yellow shirts, whatever, you know. So that, I really, you know, when I really reflect myself, that was a fear that, you know, I want to be liked by people, but, you know, it's almost like a Satan is putting a fear in my heart. You know, it was amazing that, you know, last week or today, Tim mentioned it. It is so true. The fear is a gift of Satan. The gift of God is joy and happiness and peace and righteousness. That is a gift of God. That's the result of a gift of God, right? As we prepared today's sermon, I looked at his sermon, and today's sermon was all about hunting, farming, and fishing. Honey, you know, a week later, we have a blessing. And all staff member, you know, asked him, you know, today you have to really, you know, talk about the meaning of blessing and why everybody has to get a receive blessing. And you know, like he's going like a totally off direction and talking about farming and hunting. And I go, can you explain to me why you're talking about this? And, you know, we all know that a lot of, you know, people will come here and a lot of people will move here. Then, but what kind of, you know, nation are we trying to build here? Do we try to, like, consolidate all the power and all the donations so that, you know, Hyungjim and I can live like a kings and, you know, buying expensive cars and build a castle? Is that what we're trying to do? Or what are we trying to do? We are trying to build a kingdom that true Father wanted us to build. Mutual prosperity is there. Freedom is maximized. Responsibility is, you know, that is to come along with the maximized freedom. And with a free association, nobody's forcing us to be together here. But we are here centered on God. And that's why we want to talk about this future. We are not only stopping here, but with the things that Father empowering us, self-empowerment that Christ gave us, we become a true citizen of our Chunhyuk-gu for His kingdom.
Amen. Amen, amen. She challenges, look, she's wearing green. See, my point was, look, we want everybody make your YouTube channel. Because when you become a public person, you'll see. And people will see. Satan will always try to grab you. One thing they always just try to be, oh, you always talk about peace and love. You can't be having a gun, this kind of thing. And so what I do, I made my video where I show my gun. You see what I mean? Don't let Satan pigeonhole you. Amen? The more things you show, the more things you're transparent with. Say, you know what? This is how God made me. And I am not here to please you. Or I'm not here to please a person on YouTube. I'm here to be strong in my anointing and with what God gave. Blessed with me. Amen? And that's so important. We want to challenge. That's what we're talking about. You know, challenging those epigenetics and letting God be glorified. Let's end with Chan 8:13. Let's read together. When you pass the age of 60, you should retire from public life. Return to the farm village in your hometown. Cultivate the earth and prepare to go to the spirit world. You will be busy preparing for the spirit world. For this reason, you should devote yourself sincerely and deeply involve yourself in a farming village, taking responsibility to guide its people the way I would. Amen. Amen. All right, everybody, let's rise up. And let's ask God's anointing upon us as we really are pioneering. We're pioneering Chaninguk. We're getting it back on track with God. This every single one of our families here. So God has to, we are to ask God's protection upon us. Father, we ask your protection upon us this day, Father. As Father, as we look past the blessing which is coming up. And Father, as we look past and beyond the tribulation that is also coming up, the judgment that is coming. The judgment is not to be the end of the world. The judgment is to usher in the new millennial reign of your kingdom, Father. But you need boots on the ground. You need people who are aligned with you, Father, who are willing to go out into the wilderness to build the kingdom. And Father, you have started with this group right here. More of them will be joining us, but they want to learn. They want to know how God is moving. And Father, when they come here next week from around the world, we will be able to share these things with them. We will share the shattering paradigm shifts that are happening, leaving the satanic systems and boxes that we are expected to jump into and radically moving with your Holy Spirit anointing, with your empowered vision, with your discernment of spirit, with your freedom that you have given us, and with the responsibility, creativity, accountability, the righteousness which you have given to us by your blood. Father, we don't take that any of that in vain. All of that was purchased by your suffering. And Father, we ask you this day that you would anoint each one of the families here, that they would also be the builders and owners of Chaninguk, that we are setting a totally different paradigm than the Chungpyeong centralized tyranny that they wish to impose on the world. But Father, we are standing with you in relating with you, relating with our brothers and sisters, being each other's keeper, protecting each other, and standing, each and every one of us, in our responsibility to be great citizens of Chaninguk. Those who are moving towards your vision, who are building your kingdom, who are raising our children to be free and to be responsible, to love you with all your might, to unleash their creativity and unlock epigenetic levels for your glory and not theirs. Father, anoint these families that are gathered here and the ones that will come in the very short future. Bring us through the tribulation. And Father, as we follow you through the tunnel or even the valleys of the shadow of death, we do not fear. We will not fear because you are with us. And we will dwell in your house, the great house of the kingdom of God. We thank you and give you all the praise, glory, and honor, and we are grateful to be a part of your moving of your spirit, and we give you all the thanks. In our own names, the Central Blessed Families, we report, and in your precious name, we pray. Amen and adieu and amen. Bless your brother or sister next to you. Say, be strong and of good courage. Be free and responsible. Amen. Bless you.